The screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Without much delay, I would be starting. Okay, Aditi?
Okay, sir.
Okay, see, today we'll be having a discussion on carcinoma penis and genital innate trauma. So the most common histological pattern that will be asked by the examiner in your exam is squamous cell carcinoma. What is the most common histology? Squamous cell carcinoma. What may be other histologies? Mesenchymal tumors, malignant melanoma, basal cell carcinoma, or it can be a metastasis. CA penis, most common decade of presentation is the sixth decade, but 40% patients are less than 40 years. Phimosis is associated in 50%. Etiology, as you all know, is HPV 16, 18. 31, 33, most commonly, the question will be asked on HPV 16. Okay. In your NEET exam as well as in your final exams. Another favorite question of the examiners is, what is the differential diagnosis of CA penis? So learn this by heart. Condyloma acuminatum, Buschke-Lowenstein tumor, balanitis xerotica obliterans. These are non-infectious DDs of CA penis. And what are the infectious one? Chancre, chancroid, herpes, LGV, and tuberculosis. So all these six or seven conditions, you should be knowing by heart. Okay. Am I clear on this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So see, what are the pre-malignant lesions, or what may come in the differential diagnosis? Cutaneous horn, pseudoepitheliomatous, Michaelis, keratotic, balanitis, Bowenoid papulosis, condyloma acuminata, Kaposi sarcoma, leukoplakia, BXO. What is BXO? It presents as a whitish patch on the prepuce or glands, often involving the meatus. See, how will you differentiate vitiligo from BXO? Vitiligo per se will not involve the urinary meatus, but BXO, it just looks exactly like vitiligo, but it will involve the urinary meatus mostly. Okay. You got the difference between vitiligo and BXO of the penis?
Yes, sir.
Now, this will be asked in the VIVA-YC and in the NEET exams, Buschke-Lowenstein tumor or varicose carcinoma. Theek hai. The thing is, it will invade locally, but it will never metastasize. This is the question asked in the MCQs and in the VIVA-YC as well. It will show no signs of malignant change, but it will destruct the adjacent tissue. So the treatment is total penectomy. Some cases laser can be used, but mostly total penectomy is used. Okay. Then there is some treatment with 5-fluorouracil, podophyllin, radiation and all. Now, two conditions which are carcinoma in situ for CA penis are erythroplasia of Kurath and Bowen's disease. Now, any one of you tell me, what is the difference between carcinoma in situ and invasive carcinoma? Come on, quick. What is the difference between carcinoma in situ and invasive carcinoma? Which membrane?
The basement membrane is not invaded, then it is carcinoma in situ.
Very nice, very nice. Yes, correct. So just have a look. This is erythroplasia of Kurath. When the lesion is involving the glands or the prepucial skin, it is erythroplasia of Kurath. And when the same thing, because both the things are histologically similar, and when the same thing involves the penile shaft, okay, the skin of the shaft or the corporal bodies, then it is known as Bowen's disease. Both the things are histologically similar, but location-wise, they are different. These are red, velvety, well-marginated lesion of the glans penis. They may ulcerate, they may not ulcerate. Okay. What is Bowen's disease? It is sharply defined plaques of scaly erythema on the penile shaft. Appearance can be the appearance of Bowen's disease. This one, the appearance of Bowen's disease can be confused with superficial basal cell carcinoma, eczema, psoriasis. Invasive carcinoma is is documented to be 5% to 33% in Bowen's disease, not in erythroplasia of Kirat. So if the examiner asks you, among the two, which has the propensity to invade the basement membrane, it is Bowen's disease. Okay. If the lesion is on the prepuce, go with circumcision or the excision of a margin. If it's on the glans, you can use a topical cream, 5-fluoro-USL or imiquimod, and radiotherapy in cases of resistant disease. Coming to the invasive carcinoma, India and especially the northeast part of the country, they lead in the incidence of penile carcinoma. Exact etiology is known, but why the incidence is more in that part of the country is not specifically clear. Okay, what is the common location for a CA penis? Glans 48%, prepuce 21%. These two lead. What is the etiology? Lack of neonatal circumcision, poor hygiene, phimosis, associated in 50% of the cases, HPV 16, 18, 31, 33. Remember this by heart, 16, 18, 31, 33. Okay, tobacco exposure, penile trauma, okay, and some non-convincing, not exactly clear, but gonorrhea, syphilis, and all those things have been associated in the past. Exact correlation is doubtful, but yes, we have documentation to prove that these are there in cases of CA penis. Maybe the infection may be secondary, but these are there. Now, I hope you have all you all know the anatomy of the penis. The Buck's fascia and the tunica albuginea, which cover the penis, they resist the hematological spread of the carcinoma. They are like an anatomical barrier to the malignancy. Cases of CA penis are also associated with hypercalcemia. It is because of parathormone-related protein. This will be asked in the MCQs, NEET MCQ, definitely. Okay. Now, the lymphatic drainage. Lymphatic drainage of the penis from prepuce and shaft skin is to superficial inguinal lymph node, and from the glans and shaft is superficial plus deep inguinal lymph node. Okay. And penile drainage is bilateral. All these points are MCQs for your NEET exams. Okay. And a well-informed examiner will also ask this if you do well in your YYYC with CA penis cases. Okay. What is the name of the layer which separates the superficial inguinal lymph node and the deep inguinal lymph node? Anyone who has read this? Which is the anatomical layer which differentiates the superficial inguinal lymph node and the deep inguinal lymph node? So guess they are wrong. Fascia. First word is fascia. Second word is? What is the structure which lies there? Some fascia. If the node is above that, it is called a superficial. If it's below that, it's called as deep. What is that fascia? They'll ask you. Come on, hurry up. We don't have much time. Fascia? Fascia? Anyone? Come on, make a guess now. Make a guess. Which fascia? Okay, remember the anatomy of the groin. Fascia lata. Okay. Fascia lata. Nodes above the fascia lata are in the superficial group. Nodes below are in the deep group. It will have a significance on the management of CA penis. Am I clear on this?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Now, what may be the clinical symptoms and signs? So, as we have discussed, squamous cell carcinoma is the most common. When the examiner will ask you what is the most common symptom of CA penis, you will say that the lesion itself is the most common symptom. Lesion itself, okay, it is visible. 50% of the cases will be associated with lymph node enlargement, but of those 50%, 50% will go away with antibiotic treatment. Okay, so the incidence of infectious inguinal lymph node in CA penis is 50%. Then again, question will be asked on priapism. Priapism is the most common symptom of metastatic CA penis. Another MCQ for NEET exams. Most common cause of death in CA penis is erosion of the femoral vessel. The inguinal node, there would be an ulcer there, and that ulcer will gradually progress and invade the vessels, the femoral vessels. So death would be by bleeding. Most common cause. And second most common cause is sepsis. along with that, you have all generalized symptoms. What may be the signs? Signs may be an ulcer in the form of small pustule, warty growth, or some lesion. Erosion and infection is always there. And yes, importantly, the urinary retention can occur because of the involvement of the urethra. The lesion might involve the urethra, and thus deviation in the path of the urine can occur. The patient may not exactly see from where the urine is coming. What may be the investigations and the biochemical investigation? Biopsy, we would discuss in the next slide. MRI is the gold standard investigation of choice to assess the depth of CAPNS. CT scan is best to assess the inguinal lymph node. See, there are a few things you need to understand clearly. Okay. Soft tissue detail of penile tumor is best imaged by MRI. Number one, physical examination provides the most reliable staging information for small distal lesion, not for all lesions. Small distal lesion hi milega exam mein. Physical examination provides the most reliable thing. This is from Campbell. If somebody asks you from where have you read all these things, huh? This is the Campbell 11th edition. Okay. Physical examination of the inguinal lesion remains the clinical gold standard for evaluating the presence of metastatic nodes in non-obese patient. If a patient has a history of inguinal surgery, if a patient is very obese, then of course you will take the help of a CT to look for the presence of lymph node. But if a patient is not obese, he has no history of any previous surgery, then physical examination of the inguinal lymph node is the gold standard to assess them. Okay. Then last but not the least, among patients with proven inguinal metastasis, CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis may help to determine those patients with poor prognostic features for cure-based surgery. And what is the role of PET CT? PET CT may be useful among patients with clinically detected inguinal mets to define the presence of pelvic or distant metastasis. The examiner will ask you in the exam, what is the name of the biopsy which we do in CAPNS? So in CAPNS, we do wedge biopsy. We do wedge biopsy. And you will say all these words. Why to do the wedge biopsy? To assess the depth of invasion. See, suppose this is the tumor. Okay. So you have to take the normal chunk of anatomical tissue along with the tumor, so you can assess the depth of the tumor. If suppose you have taken this like this incisional biopsy, you will not know what is the actual depth of the tumor. So why do we take a wedge biopsy? We take a wedge biopsy to determine the actual depth of invasion, the presence of vascular invasion, and to determine the histological grade of the lesion. Do you all know what is Broaddus classification for squamous cell carcinoma? Anyone? Broaddus classification, B-R-O-A-D-E-R. Broaddus classification for squamous cell carcinoma. What is that? Anyone? Come on, faster. Yes, no, kuch bhi bol do.
No, sir.
Okay. Mild, moderate, severe karke, it is classified as the degree of differentiation. Mildly differentiated, moderately differentiated, and poorly differentiated. In any squamous cell carcinoma, this is also potential MCQ, and it has come in our exam as well way back, I appeared in 2011, yeah, for my MS. So this was a question. The Broaddus classification is used for, it is used for squamous cell carcinoma. So this is the wedge biopsy. You got it, everyone? Now the staging, T staging, okay. TA is non-invasive verrucous carcinoma. Okay, TIS is carcinoma in situ, T1A and T1B. Okay, you see T1A and T1B, both are same. Tumor invades subepithelial connective tissue without lymphovascular invasion and is not poorly differentiated. And here T1B, it invades the subepithelial connective tissue with lymphovascular invasion and is poorly differentiated. So the differentiating point is vascular invasion. Okay, T2 is invasion in the corpus spongiosum or cavernosum. T3 is invasion in the urethra and T4 is adjacent tissues. These are the lymph nodes. N1 is palpable mobile unilateral inguinal lymph node. N2 is palpable mobile multiple or bilateral inguinal lymph node. And N3 is palpable fixed lymph nodes. M1 is distant mets and M0 is no distant mets. Now, based on the depth of the lesion, what may be the treatment? Okay. For carcinoma in situ, you can have, we will discuss the modalities later, but just in a nutshell, laser therapy, glands resurfacing or any topical therapy. For non for varicose carcinoma, non-invasive, we can go for surgical excision in the form of a circumcision to achieve a negative margin, and laser is always with us. For TA, T1, grade 1 to 3 or low-grade lesions, therapy is based on the size and position of the lesion as well as the potential side effects. It may be in the form of excision, glands resurfacing, glansectomy or radiotherapy. Again, for similar lesions on the foreskin or shaft, I can go for partial pinectomy. For T2 glands without gross cavernosum involvement, total glansectomy with or without corpora cavernosal transaction to achieve a negative surgical margin. This table is important. When you will read the entire PPT, then you will know this. Okay. And for a T2 lesion, which is the most common, you'll go for either a partial or a total pinectomy. T4 lesions, you have to go for some neoadjuvant form of treatment in form of chemo or radio. Then if the patient responds, you can go ahead with surgery. Okay. And local disease after recurrence, complete excision to achieve a negative surgical margin may require some form of annihilating surgery. And for radiotherapy in selective cases of T1, T2 and near the sulcus with a lesser 4 cm size. What are the key points for surgical treatment? This again is, I think, repetition. So in the surgical modality, what may be the goal of treatment? The goal is to preserve gland sensation whenever possible, but oncological principles should not be undermined to preserve the glands. Okay. Where can you do organ preservation? Favorable histology, TIS, TA, T1, grade 1 and grade 2. Okay. What may be the options for organ preservation? Limited excisional strategies, radiation, Mohs micrographic surgery and laser ablation. Okay. Circumcision we have discussed in the past. Now, another thing which will be asked in the NEET exams is, what is the margin? What will be the, and most commonly exams asked in the final exams as well, what will be the margin which you will take? Okay, so 2 cm wala answer nahi chalega. For grade 1, it is 5 mm margin. For grade 2, 5 mm, 10 mm for grade 3. Okay. Next, this is the appearance. We have done a glansectomy, and this is a split thickness graft which has been placed after doing a glansectomy. We have done there was a superficial lesion, and we had done a glansectomy, and the graft has been placed. The older examiners, they will ask, what is Mohs micrographic surgery? So you remove the, you slit the tumor, and after each slice, you will examine the undersurface of the tumor for the presence of carcinoma. The undersurface of the layer at which there is no tumor, at that point, you will come to know that all the tumor has been removed and there is no tumor present in the lesion. So there, that is the place from where you'll stop. Okay. So it will involve layer by layer complete excision of the penile lesion in multiple sessions with microscopic examination of the undersurface of each layer until the lesion is completely excised. Okay. So this much is enough to explain the examiner. What are the different lasers used? Carbon dioxide depth, skin depth is asked. What is the degree of infiltration? It is 0.01 millimeter. NDAG is 3 to 6 millimeter. These two are asked in the exams, both NEET and both in the VIVA-YC. 0.01 millimeter and 3 to 6 millimeter. What are the disadvantages? Tissue for tumor grading and assessment is not provided. Obviously, when you burn the tissue, you will not get any tissue for histology examination. Now, if the lesion is such that you have to go for some annihilating surgery, then what are the indications? Tumor size 4 cm or more, grade 3 lesions, and those invading deeply into the glands, urethra or corpora cavernosa. So what may be done? Partial pinectomy. This is a pick of partial pinectomy or a radical total pinectomy. So for partial pinectomy, what may be the, this will be asked by the examiners. What is partial pinectomy? So this will involve the complete clearance of the tumor, most probably indicated for a patient in whom at least 2 cm of penis is still left. proximal to the tumor. Why this 2 centimeters? So that the patient might hold the penis and void in a standing position. Okay. And possibly allow some sexual function as well, if it's important. Local recurrence rate after partial autotopinectomy ranges from 0 to 8%, again asked in the NEET exams. What may be the complications? Complications may be metal stenosis, inability to void in upright position, and spraying of the urine, and of course, inadequate sexual function. What is total penectomy? Now see, total penectomy is a misnomer. Why? Because you are transecting the penis at the level of the suspensory ligament without removal of the corporal cavernosa, which is present more proximally. So you are cutting at a superficial level. So it is not total. Okay, the term is total penectomy. When you do remove the corporal bodies as well, it is called as radical penectomy. So many examiners would be asking you, what is the difference between total penectomy and a radical penectomy? So the difference is, in total penectomy, you amputate at or near the level of the suspensory ligament of the penis, and you don't remove the corporal cavernosa bodies totally. But in radical penectomy, you remove the corporal cavernosa bodies, those cylinders, totally as well. So this is the difference. This will be asked in the exams. Now coming to the treatment of regional nodes. Okay, as we have discussed, superficial nodes are 4 to 25. This is the anatomy. I don't think this will be asked that much in your exams, but yeah, the numbers can be asked. How many numbers are there? 4 to 25. They are located in 5 groups. Actually, they are located in each quadrant where the gates of venous vein drains into the femoral vein. Okay, so in and around that SFJ junction, supralateral, infralateral, supromedial, inframedial, and central nodes. You just say in the exams, if they will ask you what are the superficial nodes, you will say, sir, nodes are centering the SFJ. Those are the central nodes. Supralateral are around the superficial circumflex iliac vein. Infralateral are along the lateral femoral cutaneous vein. Supromedial are around the superficial external pudendal. And infromedial are around the gates of venous vein. These are the 5 groups. Whatever nodes are below the facial lata, these are the deep group. And most commonly asked in the NEET and the Viva Voice is node of the cloquet, which is the most cephaloid node in the deep group, is the node of the cloquet. Okay. From there, from the deep inguinal node, the external iliac lymph nodes will receive the drainage. Okay, and then pass on to the common iliac and para-aortic. This will be a little bit tough to understand, but you see, what do I mean to say here? If the patient has a lesion which is low grade and inguinal nodes are absent, just try to listen to me. Don't look at this graph. Okay. If the patient has a small lesion, non-invasive type, low grade, and nodes are not present, then nothing needs to be done. Okay. But if the lesion is high grade, is large, and nodes are palpable, then you need to remove those nodes. You will first remove the nodes above the facial lata. You will send the node for frozen section. If the frozen section comes out, you will go below the facial lata and clear the deep inguinal lymph nodes. You will again see those nodes. And if those nodes are positive, then you will clear the pelvic nodes as well. So, ilioinguinal block dissection. Ilioinguinal block dissection is the answer. And how to do it? This is the type. See, this is the femoral vein. This is the GSV. Now, this is the incision for radical ilioinguinal lymphadenectomy. Okay. And this is the thing which we do commonly now these days. It is called as modified inguinal lymphadenectomy. So you can see this. It has a shorter skin incision. The dissection is limited. Okay, to the limitation is by whatever is lateral to the femoral artery, that area is excluded. Okay, we preserve the saphenous vein. And which is this muscle? Can anyone tell me which is this muscle where my cursor is moving? Anyone? Which muscle is this? Come on, guys. Which muscle is this? Remember your anatomy days. Which muscle is this? Anyone? Which muscle is this? The name of the muscle is mentioned in the slide as well. Chalo batao. This is the
sartorius.
Sartorius, exactly. So this is the point of origin of sartorius. And see, whenever you do this dissection, there is a large gap over here. So we transpose this muscle from the point of insertion and we'll place it over here. So this muscle will act as a cover. Okay. The complications of inguinal lymphoid dissection asked in the exams, most common are the seroma, lymphocele, flap necrosis. These will be asked, and long term will be lymphedema, which will be very severe in nature, very, very severe in nature. They occur in 5% to 21% of the cases. Most commonly, when the examiner will ask what is the immediate postoperative complication, it is seroma and flap necrosis. Then in that order, what may be the complication later on? Debilitating lymphedema. Okay. So this constituted your CA penis. Any doubts anyone has in the management of CA penis? Anyone having any doubt in the management of CA penis, or in the differential diagnosis, or in the diagnosis, or in the etiology? Anything? Because we have a lot of patients of CA penis, and definitely one of the patients will be present in the exam. Somebody or the other will get this as a short case. Anyone has any doubt? If no one has any doubt, then I'll ask some questions. Then I will ask some questions in CA penis. No one has any doubt? See, either you ask me or I should ask you. One question is allowed. Which is the most, let me ask you, since no one is asking me, which is the most common virus associated with CA penis? Most common virus associated with CA penis? Anyone? That you all would be appearing for your NEET exams.
Human papilloma or HPV.
Okay, which strain?
17.
No, not 17.
So 16, 18, 31, and 33.
Of these, which one is the most responsible? Of these, which one is the most responsible for the cases? The person answering this will get a MCQ book from me. Okay, on surgery. Okay, just let me know.
16, 18, 31, 33.
What's your name, dear? Kamlesh. Kamlesh. Okay. Do contact me after this thing. Okay.
Yes, sir.
The cousin after exam. Okay. I'll give you my book. Definitely. Good. So come on. Let's come to renal trauma. Does anyone of you have any idea how does the renal trauma occur? Does anyone has any idea? So it can be in the form of penetrating injury. Okay. In that, most common is gunshot or stab wound. Okay. It may be a blunt injury in the form of motor vehicle accident, fall from height, assault. Okay. What is important is deceleration injury. This is asked in the exams. This is deceleration injury is asked in the exams. Okay. You will not get a case of renal trauma in your case, but in the theory questions, it will come. Okay. So all these are important. Okay. And up to 90% of renal injury is due to blunt trauma, or among blunt trauma, what is important is deceleration injury. Okay, then classification is this one. You need to learn this by heart. It will be asked in the exam every alternate year. Okay, and what is asked? Difference between grade 1 and grade 2. So they are very clever. They'll just give this option. Less than 1 centimeter perforation. Sorry, laceration. Less than 1 centimeter laceration in the cortex. Which grade is this? So by looking at this less than 1, the informed students will make an assumption that this will be grade 1. No, in grade 1, there is no parenchymal laceration. In grade 1, there is only subcapsular non-expanding हिमेटोमा, सब कैप्सुलर नॉन एक्सपैंडिंग हिमेटोमा विदाउट पेनकाइमल लेसरेशन. सो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, ग्रेड वन हैज नो लेसरेशन. दिस विल बी आस्क्ड इन द एग्जाम्स. रिमेंबर दिस बाय हार्ट. ग्रेड टू इज लेस देन 1 सेंटीमीटर. ग्रेड थ्री इज मोर देन 1 सेंटीमीटर लेसरेशन. दिस इज द वे टू रिमेंबर दिस. वट इज ग्रेड फोर? ग्रेड फोर इज मेन रीनल आर्टरी और वेन इंजरी विथ कंटेंड हैमरेज. And that laceration is extending in the renal pelvis as well. And grade 5 is completely shattered kidney. Completely shattered kidney or avulsion of the renal hilum is grade 5. This is the way to remember this. See. Okay, this is the non-expanding hematoma. This is less than 1 centimeter laceration. This is more than 1 centimeter laceration. This is grade 4, extending into the pelvis and in the segmental vessels as well. Pedicle is involved. And this is 5 is completely shattered kidney and avulsion of the pedicle. Am I clear on this, students?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. There have been off late some changes, but you can skip it for now. Okay. What is the diagnosis? How to make a diagnosis? Obviously, history is there of some injury, some sort of injury. Presentation may be shock, hematuria, pain. Urine analysis, gross hematuria, microscopic hematuria, and the degree of hematuria will not predict the severity of renal injury. Why? Because the PCS might not be involved. The pelvic crestal system might not be injured. So you will never know what is the grade of the injury by just looking at the urine analysis. And these are the other investigations, CT, ultrasound, and ethnoclet scans. Hematuria is there, shock is there, flank bruising, flank pain is there. How to there's ABCD, all of you know, airway, breathing, circulation, disability. This is how you have to write in the exam. This is how you have to write whenever you get a 10-mark question. Whenever you get a 10-mark question, mode of injury, one thing, classification of injury, another thing, then diagnosis and evaluation. In evaluation, don't just rush to nephrectomy, renography, this and that, airway, breathing, circulation, disability. I think this table, the textbook of Manipal, if I'm not wrong, it has everything starting with A, B, C, D, E. This is a wonderful thing for a long question, for a trauma question. This is the ideal thing to start. And in the practical also, this is the correct method to start. Okay. So what are the indications? If a patient has presented to you, what are the indications for renal imaging in that patient of trauma? All penetrating injuries with a likelihood of renal injuries, you have to send that patient for a CT if the patient is hemodynamically stable. All blunt trauma cases with significant acceleration, deceleration mechanism, you have to send the patient for a CT if the patient is stable. All blunt trauma patient with gross hematuria, send for CT if the patient is stable. All blunt trauma patient with macroscopic hematuria and hypotension, send for CT if the patient is stable. And all pediatric patients with greater than 5 RBCs per hyperfield, all these investigations, all these are indications for a renal imaging, provided the patient is stable. What may be the modalities for investigation? Single shot IVP, ultrasound, angiography. Kyo karte hain, dekh lo. IVP, single shot. Why do you want to do a single shot IVP? Just let me know. Why do you want to do a single shot imaging? Suppose you are rushing the patient to the operation theater. You are rushing the patient to the operation theater, but still you need to do a single shot IVP or something, some sort of anything. Why? Some sort of investigation has to be done before opening the patient to do something. Suppose tumko nephrectomy karna hai. Then one might ask, then what if you have to do a nephrectomy, what is the need for investigation? Then what would you say? How would you defend this IVP, single shot IVP, intra-op? Anyone? Kamlesh? Now Kamlesh will say, sir has known my, sir has the, will be asking me each and every time. What is the need to do a single shot IVP, intraoperatively? What is the need? Chalo. Apply logic, apply your brains.
For any obstruction, sir.
Not exactly. Anyone else? You are going to remove or repair one kidney. Suppose you are going to remove that kidney. What about the other kidney? Suppose if the patient has only one kidney since birth, then suppose the patient is of unilateral renal agenesis, only one kidney is there. Now you get me? Why do you want to do a single shot investigation before operating the patient or during operating the patient? You got my point? Did you all get it? Why do you do a single shot, some sort of investigation before operating the patient?
Yes, sir.
Why? Tell me.
To make sure that the other kidney is functional in case we are going to remove one kidney.
Yes, yes. Many of you would become trauma surgeons. Many of you will become great surgeons. Many of you will become great radiologists. And always remember this. In cases of trauma, you will be under stress. But in that moment of stress, mistakes happen. Okay. So you first need to keep your calm. And while doing a surgery or while reporting a CT or ultrasound, apart from looking at the injured organ, you need to look at the other organs as well. And kidney is very important. Everything is important, but kidneys to a layman is very important. And straight away, if you do a very good job and repair that kidney or remove that kidney, and God forbid, if that patient has only one kidney or the other kidney is not functional, it is atrophic, it is ectopic, it is pelvic, then straight away, all the blame and everything, the hell would break loose and everything would be on you. Okay. So the life of a trauma surgeon and the life of a emergency radiologist. We don't have this concept of emergency radiologist in our country because all the... Oh, we'll discuss it some other time. Okay. So now CT scan. What can you get from CT scan? Anatomical and functional detail. Staging, of course, of the injury, associated organ injury, and what may be the what was the modality which will take for managing. CT finding may be of urinary extravasation, hematoma. See, this is what is the suggestion for a UPG avulsion or a renal pelvic injury. It is urinary extravasation medial to the kidney will suggest a UPG avulsion. Hematoma medial to the kidney will suggest pedicle injury. Lack of contrast enhancement will suggest arterial injury. Contrast gaya nahi kidney mein. Okay. This is the left kidney. This is the right kidney. You can see laceration. You can see this part. Okay. Soft tissue injury medial to the right kidney. See this is the area where something has happened. Okay. Here. Hematoma medial to the kidney. Okay. Here again. Left kidney, you see this area. Okay. See, infarction, because some vessel has gone, so that area is not getting any supply. All these areas are enhancing, but this wedge of area, it is not enhancing. Okay. So, infarction. Subcapsular hematoma. See, this is the hematoma. Subcapsular hematoma. See, the contour is maintained here, but not over here. Okay. Perirenal hematoma. See, this is the kidney. This is the hematoma going all along. This is the perirenal hematoma. Okay. But still confined in the Jota's fascia. This is the fascia which has confined the hematoma. Okay. One-shot IVP, there is a limited continuing role for intraoperative one-shot IVP. Main purpose of the one-shot IVP is to assess the presence of a functioning contractile kidney. We have discussed this. Coming to the management, non-operative management is very, very important. Very, very important. Becomes the standard of care in hemodynamically stable patients with grade 1 to grade 3. Experts agree that patients with grade 4 and 5 injuries more often require surgical exploration, but even these high-grade injuries can be managed without renal operation if carefully staged and selected. So in the exam, you have to say 1, 2, 3, nothing doing. You just stay put and see the patient. Grade 4 or 5, some sort of intervention in form of renography or nephrectomy has to be done. But even in those cases, if you are monitoring the patient, then they can get away without surgery. Okay. No routine CT imaging is required in patients without symptoms. No routine CT imaging is required in patients without symptoms. Okay. And when do you repeat a CT in a case of renal trauma? Between 36 to 72 hours after initial injury. Okay. For grade 3 to grade 5, not for grade 1 and grade 2. Okay. This you have to mention. This is asked in the exams also. What is the timing for a repeat CT? Options will be given 1 to 10, 10 to 15, 15 to 30, and 30 to 70. So this is the option to click. What are the absolute indications for operative management? Hemodynamic instability with shock, you have to operate the patient. Expanding pulsatile renal hematoma, you have to operate. UPGA disruption, you have to operate. And pedicle injury, you have to operate. What are the relative indications in which you might or might not operate? Are urinary extravasation with significant renal parenchymal devascularization, injury with colonic or pancreatic injury, you might or might not, or you may call your other colleagues from general surgery or GI surgery, delayed diagnosis of a renal artery injury, of course. Okay, so this is in a nutshell, what are the indications of absolute and relative. Principles, kya hai bhai surgical exploration ke? Adequate exposure, transabdominal midline laparotomy, this will be, this you can write in your exams. Early control of renal vessels, exposure, proper exposure. And the decision, the golden question is, do we repair the kidney or we remove the kidney? Okay, what are the principles for renal deconstruction? Complete renal exposure, debridement of the non-viable tissue, hemostasis, well done. Hemostasis, watertight closure of the PCS and coverage of the defect. Okay, so these are the various forms of injury. So you see, this is the injury. You are doing a polar nephrectomy over here. This is the lower pole. You have done an nephrectomy and you are repairing it and putting a omental pedicle fat. Now this is a bullet which has pierced through the parenchyma. The defect is, the PCS is, the vessels are closed, defect is closed, and some gelatin or gel foam has been put in for hemostasis. Okay, renovascular injuries, they occur, but in those, you immediately have to make a diagnosis and repair or do a nephrectomy. There is no other way around. What may be the complications? Persistent urinary extravasation. If there is much of necrosis, then patient might have fever afterwards. Okay. Yes, delayed renal bleeding can occur, and it can occur within 21 days. Again, asked in the NEET exams, till what day delayed bleeding can occur? Till 21 days. Perinephric abscess, hypertension because of the kidney will become a Paige kidney. Again, asked in your PG exams, what is a Paige kidney? Okay, see, compression of the renal parenchyma because of the extravasated blood, this will lead to a Paige kidney, and Paige kidney would lead to activation of the RAS and thus hypertension. Okay, follow-up is for 3 months with necessary ultrasound and gene analysis, blood pressure management and everything. Coming to the ureteric injury, presentation might be a leak, infection, anuria, hematuria, obstruction, etiology, external trauma, very rare. Usually it is surgical trauma, maybe a gynecology surgery or doing a ureteroscopy. This is the classification AST grade 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One is contusion and hematoma without devascularization. Grade 2, less than 50% transection. Grade 3, more than 50% transection of the ureter. Grade 4 is complete laceration, less than 2 cm, and grade 5 is avulsion more than 2 cm. Diagnostic test most commonly done is CT urography. Okay. Treatment may be one-stage treatment, or you do some PCN and come out. That is how it is managed. This PPT will help you out with the etiology and everything. You can do a PCN, you can remove sutures, you can put a DJ stent. See, this is important. This is the upper ureter, this is the mid ureter, this is the lower ureter. So, exam in the exam, it will be asked, what are the methods to treat a upper ureter injury? It is direct ureterouterostomy or trans ureterouterostomy. What is the meaning of trans ureterouterostomy? Anyone? Trans ureterouterostomy, what is the meaning? This is one ureter, this is the other ureter. If this part is injured and length is not adequate, you just make this ureter mobilize and attach to this part of the ureter. This is trans ureterostomy. For middle injuries, direct ureterostomy and trans ureterostomy. And for the lower ureteric injuries, you have reimplantation, swashitch, Boris prep, and everything. So this slide is important for the management part. Okay. Again, questions are asked based on the defect. If the defect is 2 to 3 cm, what can be done? If the defect is 4 to 5 cm, what can be done? The most commonly asked question is, what is the ureteric defect for which Boris flap is done? So a Boris flap, you make a flap from the bladder, you make a tongue from the bladder, you take a tongue from the bladder and anastomose the ureter to it. So this is done for a 12 to 15 centimeter defect of the ureter. Okay, this is how the ureters are anastomosed. Okay, you have spatulated on the opposite sides and this is the anastomosis. Bower interpositions, we have done this in our department, and by the grace of the God, the patient is still doing fine. We have interposed the ileum in a case of a uteroscopy where the total ureter was injured. So this is the diagram, okay? This is the part which is removed, and ileum, it is anastomosed to the pelvis at the upper side and to the bladder in the lower side. So this is how it looks like. Okay, this is the Bowie's flap I was talking about. This thing is taken as a flap and is removed, and then it is tubularized and attached to the upper part of the ureter. Okay, coming to the bladder injuries. Bladder injuries can be penetrating or blunt injuries. What may be the other causes? RTA, kicks to the bladder, stab, endoscopic trauma, diathermy, and instrumentation. See, it may be of intraperitoneal type or extraperitoneal type, or it may be a combined type. Okay. How does the intraperitoneal bladder injury occur? 20% cases are because of intraperitoneal injury, occurs due to blow or kick. Blunt trauma more likely results in intraperitoneal rupture. What happens in children and adults? Since the pediatric bladder is mostly intraperitoneal, any injury in the pediatric patients is intraperitoneal injury. Okay. And blunt trauma in an adult with a full bladder, okay, then intraperitoneal injury can occur. What may be the clinical feature? Sudden pain in the suprapubic region, shock, diffuse pain, distension, lately results in peritonitis because peritoneum is involved, guarding rigidity, ye sab cheeze hongi intraperitoneal injury mein. Emergency laparotomy is the only treatment for intraperitoneal repair, nothing else. In emergency laparotomy, for an intraperitoneal repair, you have to do a emergency laparotomy. You have to say this in the exam. Extraperitoneal injury, most common, 80% of the cases will have 80% of the cases will have extraperitoneal injury. The injury will occur secondary to adjacent pelvic fracture or an avulsion tear at fixation points at the pubopostotic ligament. Most commonly occurs in the non-distended bladder, such as in road traffic accident. Okay, see, this is a extraperitoneal injury. This is the extraperitoneal injury. This is the bowel. This is the peritoneum. And see, there is suprapubic tenderness and swelling, fullness. So, with palpation only, you can make out whether it is an external, whether it is an extrarenal, extra cycle or intracycle, this thing, injury. Okay. Now, the clinical features are collection of urine and blood in the extraperitoneal space. Patient will not be able to void. Abdominal fullness, scrotal swelling, stanguri, inability to micturate, and often associated with shock and other injuries. This is asked in the exam. This is the sunburst appearance. Most favored MCQs of examiners from bladder injury. This is the sunburst appearance, most common in the intraperitoneal rupture. It might be also kept in your spotting exams, in the final year spotting exam. Sunburst appearance, dye in the peritoneum. This is the bladder ruptured, dye in the peritoneum. Okay, this is the tear drop deformity. This is suggestive of an extraperitoneal rupture. Okay, the dye has not gone in the peritoneum, but it has gone adjacent. So it becomes a flame shaped or tear drop deformity. Again, as in the MCQs, suggestive of extraperitoneal rupture. Treatment we have all discussed. Urethral stricture we have discussed last time, but look at the urethral injuries. Posterior urethra has maybe because of fracture pelvis or catheter insertion. Anterior urethra may be because of falling stride or external trauma. See, this is the posterior urethral injury. In the posterior urethral injury, this is the level of the urogenital diaphragm, and at the prostatomembranous junction, it has become disjunct. So this prostate has gone up like a pie in the sky, and this all has gone up. Okay, this is the posterior, and this is the anterior urethral injury. This collection is in the attachment of the Colles fascia. Nothing has gone anywhere but scrotum and penile. This swelling has occurred here. This is normal. Do you get my point? Just by examination only, you do a PR and you get a high riding prostate like a pie in the sky, it is suggestive of a posterior urethral injury. But if you examine the patient, if he has scrotal edema, penile edema, blackening in the skin, then most commonly suggestive of anterior urethral injury. Okay. Clinical feature is the is bladder meatus, retention of urine, hematuria, swelling of the perineum, penis, and scrotum. No immediate catheterization in a case of anterior urethral injury or posterior urethral injury. No immediate catheterization. Bailey, older Bailey, sometime has said that in a case of partial injury, you can introduce a gentle catheter. Gentle attempt at catheter insertion can be done. But in the MCQs, if this option is there, then no catheterization. Catheterization is contraindicated. Okay. Other things you all know. Now, can anyone tell what is the mode of injury here? And what is this, where the arrow is pointing? We have discussed this in our previous classes, I remember correctly. What is this thing in the anterior urethra? And what is this investigation? So what is this investigation? Just let me know. This is the catheter placed in the penis, maybe in the fossa navicularis. And what is this investigation? What is this? Anyone? We have studied this in detail here. Aise mat bolo. Which two investigations we have studied for stricture urethra? RGU, MCU. What is this? RGU or MCU or both? Urethra has die. Even the bladder has die. And this is the site of extravasation. Is this RGU? Is this MCU? Or is this combined RGU, MCU? Anyone? This is the point where you can make mistakes and you can ask. And you can learn things, not in the exams. There is no point in not asking a question, but you have to get it clear in your minds, because it is equally important, not for your exams, but for your NEET PG as well. One question will make a difference, dear students. Okay. This is a combined. Is it a combined or not?
RGU.
अरे भाई अमिताभ बच्चन की तरह आवाज आई यार. दिस इज नॉट आरजीयू, दिस इज द कंबाइंड स्टडी ना. सी देयर इज इंजरी ओवर हियर. ओके. एंड देयर इज डाई एज वेल इन द ब्लैडर. देयर इज डाई एज वेल इन द ब्लैडर. सो हाउ कैन इट बी आरजीयू इफ यू पुट समथिंग फ्रॉम बिलो एंड दिस इज द पॉइंट ऑफ एक्स्ट्रावासेशन. हाउ द डाई विल प्रोग्रेस टू द ब्लैडर. सो दिस इज अ कंबाइंड एंटीरियर कंबाइंड एंटीगेट एंड रिट्रोगेट सिस्टोयूरेथ्रोग्राम और top and downogram. Other name is top and downogram. Okay. Treatment we have all discussed before. For a posterior urethral injury, you put an SPC, you do a delayed surgical correction. Why? To decrease the incidence of incontinence, impotence, and stricture. For anterior urethral injuries, again, SPC, follow up urethrography after 2 to 3 weeks, and then do a surgical repair. When you do an immediate repair in cases of intraperitoneal bladder injury, and fracture penis. Now I will conclude by showing you two pictures and you will give me the answer. These pictures have come in the previous year's NEET exams. I have taken the pain to show you these two pictures. So what is this picture? What is this appearance of the testis and what is this picture? I'm giving you a clue. Patient is a diabetic. Patient is an uncontrolled diabetic and he has a history of a necrotizing infection.
Porneus gangrene.
Yes. What's your name, buddy?
Sir Priyansh Garg.
Okay, very nice. Next picture. What is this? What is this? This we are concluding. I think this is the last image. We have finished this. What is this image? It was asked in the exam. Sorry. Last one. What did you say? What is this image? Yeah.
Fracture
penis. And what is this defect? In which layer? This defect. You can see this defect. All of you can appreciate. Can all of you appreciate this defect? See, you can see this defect, na?
Corpus. Yes, sir.
So the fracture penis is because of injury in which layer?
Corpora cavernosa.
No.
Tunica.
Very good. Who was that?
Kamlesh.
Kamlesh again. So, tumhari book pakki hai, Kamlesh. And last but not the least, again asked in the MCQs very commonly, most favorite. What is this appearance? Single line question, single line answer. You get the full marks.
Testicular torsion?
No. It is again a case of a fractured penis. But what is the name of this appearance? Anyone? I cannot see how many students are there with us right now. How many of you are there present? This is eggplant deformity. Eggplant. Okay. Seen most commonly in cases of CA penis. This is eggplant deformity. Okay. Thanks for the patient listening. Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.